What's up, guys?
I want to welcome everybody back to the channel. As always, the channel's name is The Third Earnest. I'm Ernest Adiano III, hence the name, and we break down rap music, hip-hop. But if you're new here, consider subscribing. If you like what you see, check out the other videos. We're breaking off of Eminem today, and we're going on to J. Cole. This song is For Your Eyes Only off of the album For Your Eyes Only. And I chose this song because, unfortunately, it now has a very strong connection to me because I had just lost a friend on Easter who the whole thematic elements of this song seem to fit what happened. Now, before we get started, I just want to speak on the album, actually, For Your Eyes Only. A lot of people feel like it's not J. Cole's strongest work because the songs, they're not really, you know, they're not hits per se. They're not meant for radio. It's only 10 tracks. I think we waited between two albums. I think it was like 3 years. And we only got 10 tracks between 2014, Forest Hills Drive, and For Your Eyes Only. But it's important to know, and I feel like at this point, a lot of people know, but when the album first came out and it was being criticized, a lot of people didn't realize that this is a concept album and we're not actually hearing J. Cole's voice. We're not hearing it from a first-person point of view. He's narrating the story of his friend who he lost to the streets. You actually don't realize until the very last song that we're not listening to J. Cole. We're listening to J. Cole tell a story of his friend because we only hear J. Cole in the very last verse talking from his own point of view. That's the very first time that we actually hear him talking to somebody from his own point of view. And I don't know if you can tell already, but my normal upbeat mood and things like that are probably not going to be there today because this song has very important meaning to me literally as of 24 hours ago. Me and all of my friends who we've grown up with at least over a decade, 15 years, we lost one of our friends recently. And when I mean recently, I mean yesterday, Easter. You know, and a lot of YouTube and the YouTube platform in general, just because the way it works, you know, a lot of people try to portray a happy personality all the time. They try to portray excitement and things of that nature, but that's not real life. And I know a lot of y'all are here, and a lot of the people that are already subscribed to me know that I don't like to be anything other than real. So I'm not going to try to put on this really happy face and this really upbeat, energetic, welcome back to the channel, because that's not what's going on in my life right now. It's literally been 24 hours since I've lost someone who I would consider a brother. His story is very similar to the story in this song and the story of this album. He had, you know, troubles with the law early in his life. He had a son, turned things around. He was my barber and, you know, we lost him. And that's just a fact. That's the way life goes. This is real life. He was 35 years old. So I'm basically dedicating this video and this song breakdown to him and his family because this is a deep cut on one of J. Cole's least popular albums. So I'm sure a lot of people have not heard this track, or if they have, they haven't really paid too much attention to it or even gotten all the way through it because the song is almost 9 minutes long. If y'all guys wouldn't mind commenting below, just like we did for one of the subscribers, one of the family members that we have here when she lost her daughter, you know, just send prayers up for my friend and his family. If you're not one that believes in God or you're not religious, then just send positive vibes that way because they can sure use it right now. And so can I, and so can all of my friends group. But let's just go ahead and jump on into it so you can see exactly what I'm talking about on why this song fits what's happening and why it ties in the whole For Your Eyes Only album.
For your eyes only. For your eyes only.
Before we get started, the beat selection is bomb because it's very slow paced. It allows him to tell the story that he's trying to tell. One thing that you cannot take away from J. Cole is that he is a master storyteller. It's crazy that he's able to put 10 songs together from another person's perspective and have you think the entire time that we're talking through the eyes of J. Cole, when really J. Cole's just talking through the eyes of somebody else, and you don't realize until the last verse of this track.
Hey, niggas be dying on the daily. It seems my dreams faded for far too long. The consequences deadly. Can't visualize myself as nothing but a criminal. Control the block, serving up rocks and stay subliminal. Cause young niggas is hard-headed, they letting off. Full of adrenaline, ignorant to what death can cause. Ain't no coming back, family dressed in black. Plus it's hot now, the cops outside. It's hard to flip a pack.
So you can already see that he's telling the story of his friend, and you don't know it's his friend. Like I said, you know, if when your first time going through the album, you don't know that he's telling the story of someone else, but you can tell like the animosity and the downtroddenness and just the sadness of this person's life. Like, had to resort to drug dealing in the streets. You know, he sees all these youngsters out here who are packing heat and, you know, quick to shoot up a block or quick to shoot at somebody, but ignorant to what death can cause. Death causes a lot of issues, a lot of heartbreak. I was with my friend's family over Easter at night, and everybody was just out of it, as you would expect. You know, we lost somebody at 35 years old. And the thing about J. Cole and what makes his writing so powerful and so potent is the fact that he knows when to flip from a storyteller to an actual, like, lyrical MC. Throughout this 9-minute track, I don't think that there's a single simile or metaphor or wordplay or anything, because he doesn't want you to be focused on the wordplay. He doesn't want you thinking about words that are on past lines and how fire they were and losing the actual message because the words are so strong. It's a very straightforward track, other than the fact that it's a master of storytelling. It's fire. He says, people dying out here on the daily, it seems my dreams have faded for far too long. The consequence is deadly. The consequence of him losing his dreams and having to resort to the streets is deadly because of the fact that people lose their lives every day in the streets. It sucks to lose a life. That's somebody's child. And that's normally, these drug dealers aren't 70, 80 years old. They're normally 20 to 25. And he says, I can't visualize myself as nothing but a criminal. That's important because in the story, the person has felonies. They have charges that it makes it hard for them to get a job in the real world. So it just falls into this vicious cycle of criminality. You can already hear almost the subliminal underlying tones of death, just by the way that the tone of the song is. He even says the consequence is deadly, foreshadowing to the fact that he lost his life. We didn't even know it at this point in the album that this was written for somebody else, much less at this person that had died. But the foreshadowing is there. It's fire.
It's hard to flip a pack, and my daughter gotta eat. Her mama be stressing me like I ain't the one who put them J's on her feet. Like I ain't out in the field like that. I might be low for the moment, but I will bounce back despite the charges.
He had to resort to the drug game. And then on top of that, the drug game ain't really even paying out like it used to because the cops are all over the place. And we got baby mama issues. Like, he's out of the life of his daughter when he really actually is in that daughter's life as much as he can be. And the most important line, at least as of now to me, I might be low for the moment, but I will bounce back. Anyone who's ever gone through adversity has built that type of resistance to being down. My friend, he had that same exact type of mentality. He wouldn't let anything get him down. That's why I feel like we lost such an important person in our little community and in our life, because he saw every down moment as an opportunity to be a better person.
I might be low for the moment, but I will bounce back despite the charges. Back to the wall, I fight regardless, screaming fuck the law, my life is lawless. That's what you call it, ain't gotta be no psychic to see this is like the farthest thing from heaven. This is hell and I don't mean that hyperbolic. I tried to find employment even if it's white but tallest, but these felonies be making life the hardest. Resisting the temptation to run up and swipe a wallet, or run up on your yard, snatch your daughter bike and pawn it. That's why I write this sonnet. If the pressure get too much for me to take, and I break, play this tape for my daughter and let her know my life is on it. Let her know my life is on it.
For your eyes.
For your eyes only.
For your eyes, do you understand? For your eyes, do you understand me? For your eyes, do you understand? For your eyes, do you understand me?
This little section, it's basically my friend's life in like 8-9 bars. He said, back to the wall, I fight regardless, screaming, fuck the law, my life is lawless. That's a dope line, that wordplay there. This is how a lot of people feel who are running out there in the streets or are having to hustle or who have caught felonies before or feel like they're being attacked or feel like they're being singled out by police. You ain't gotta be no psychic to see that this is the farthest thing from heaven. This is hell and I don't mean no hyperbolic. That's literally not a phrase. I mean that literally, like my life is a living hell, but I'm trying to make the best of it. I'm trying to find employment even if it's wiping toilets, but these felonies be making life the hardest. Like, this is why a lot of felons and why a lot of people get trapped into the vicious cycle of jail, because a lot of people don't want to hire felons, obviously. So they have to go and resort to doing other things to feed and to provide for their family. And I'm not saying it's right that they do that. I'm not saying it's right that you go into the drug game or you don't have options. You do have options, but at a certain point, you stay patient as possible, but eventually you're gonna break if nothing is working out your way. And that's what he says here, resisting the temptation to run up and swipe a wallet because it's an easy buck, or swipe your daughter's bike and pawn it. It's anonymous. No one ever knows that anything happened. It's almost like no harm, no foul in his eyes because he's gotta do what he's gotta do. And he says, and that's why I write this sonnet. If the pressure gets too much for me to take and I break, play this tape for my daughter and let her know my life is on it. Literally, his life is on it. This is foreshadowing for J. Cole's last verse. And that resonates with me even stronger now because I feel like this is the way that we gotta live. Because my friend had a son who's like, I don't know how old he is. He's under 5 years old for sure. He won't remember this, which I guess is one of the only silver linings in this, is that his son won't have memory of his dad's passing. But he's also going to live without his actual biological father, which is a tragedy, to say the least. Now I feel like we got to live in his honor and that his name is held up through our lives.
For your eyes, you probably grown now, so the song will hit you. If you hearing this, unfortunately means that I'm no longer with you. In the physical, not even sure if I believe in God, but because you still alive, it got me praying that the spiritual is real. So I...
Do you see how this song might have caused some confusion because of the things that he's saying? Like, if you thought that this whole album was based off of J. Cole's point of view, like, these are all foreshadowing steps to the fact that this album was not written in J. Cole's point of view. He says, you're probably grown now, so this song will hit you. Like, he's talking to his kid, saying, you're gonna actually understand the message now that you're grown, so it's gonna hit you a little bit harder. If you're hearing this, unfortunately, it means that I'm no longer with you, at least in the physical. Like, I'll still be in your memory, I'll still be in your life because people will keep me alive. And I'm not even sure if I believe in God, but because you're still alive, it got me praying that the spiritual is real, so I could be a part of you still. This song is eerily similar to like my friend's life. He didn't believe in God. I mean, he believed in something, you know, he didn't know what the situation was up there. You know, he had a hard life, so it's easy to understand why people who have extremely rough lives, why they believe that there might not be anybody watching over them. But even so, that's a powerful line saying that I didn't believe in God, but I'm praying now to God that the actual spiritual is real, so that way I can still be a part of your life because I will no longer be there physically.
So I can be a part of you still. My pops was killed too, so I know how part of you feels. Maybe you hate me, maybe you miss me, maybe you spite me. Life goes in cycles. Maybe you'll date a nigga just like me. I hope not. I'm tired of dope spots and fiends to smoke rocks. I seen far too many niggas' hopes rot. I'm writing this because me and the devil had a dance. Now I see death around the corner, apologizing in advance.
So you see how now he's talking about the devil, heaven and hell. Like, I didn't believe in the spiritual and heaven and hell at the first verse. Now we're talking about God and the devil in the second verse. Like, he's starting to believe because he feels like death is around the corner. My pops was killed too, so I know how part of you feels. Like, he's writing these things to his daughter in the song, knowing that there's a chance that he might lose his life to the same way that his pops lost his life. That's crazy. And there's the vicious cycle that I was talking about. He says, maybe you hate me, maybe you miss me, maybe you spite me. Like, all of the anger and emotions and the different things that you go through, it's like divorce. That's the only thing that I have to relate it to. As a child, when you're going through divorce, you feel all of these things. I hate my parents for doing this to me, for doing this to us. I miss my parents being together. I spite them. Or, you know, but then eventually you learn and understand as you grew up why the things had to happen the way they did. But that's through divorce. It's a whole nother level whenever we're talking about death of a parent due to the choices that they made to be in the streets instead of being home with you. He says, life goes in cycles. Maybe you'll date someone just like me. Like, I don't want you to be in the same position where you lose your loved one because the cycles are never ending. So he says, I hope you don't fall into that vicious cycle. I hope you break that cycle now that I'm telling you this story preemptively. And since my friend has a son who will not understand what's happening and what happened to his father until he's older, this resonates heavily with me because he's telling this story. I'm writing this because me and the devil had a dance. Now I see death around the corner. I'm apologizing in advance. But imagine having to live that life where you have to write this. It's like you're going to war. That's why they call the streets war. Because people who go to war, they write notes to their loved ones for their fellow soldiers to give to the family whenever they get back, in case they were to die in combat. It's basically what he's doing here.
Apologizing in advance. Don't know if I ever had a chance. At a glance, I'm a failure. Addicted to pushing paraphernalia. My daddy had dreams once. My eyes had a gleam once. Innocence disappeared by the age of 8 years. My pop shot up, drug related. Mama addicted, so granny raised me in projects where thugs was hanging. Blood was stained in the concrete. Older niggas I love talk like they was above. Maintaining a timesheet. That slow money. Picked up the family business. By the age of 13, 6 years later was handed sentence. Around the same time as when you came in this world. Me and your mama thinking, what the fuck we naming this girl?
You see the storytelling capability that this man possesses? He's basically running you through his entire first part of his life and how he ended up where he's at. Imagine listening to this song as his daughter, who's listening to this song for the first time because J. Cole is now allowing her to listen to it because he feels like she can understand what her passed on father is saying in the album. He says, "At a glance, I'm a failure, addicted to pushing paraphernalia." And that's something that Jay-Z says in one of his songs, that there's two sides of addiction in the drug game, the users and then the sellers, because it's so quick money that you get addicted to that quickness. He says, "At a glance, if you don't know who I am, I'm a failure, but I had dreams once. Your dad's eyes had a gleam once. The innocence disappeared by the age of 8 years because my pops was shot up. Like I was no longer that innocent person, just like you will no longer be that innocent person when you realize what happened to your father." That's a crazy line. It's like you're hearing that vicious cycle told in like eight bars maybe. My pops was shot up, drug related, my mama was addicted, so grandma raised me where the thugs was hanging in Section 8. So not only did I see my dad die at the age of 8, my mom was addicted to drugs that my dad pushed, and I didn't escape it by going and living with my grandma because she lived in the projects. People were doing the same thing. So I went from one bad environment to another. Blood was staining the concrete, and as I grew up and the people that I looked up to, they talked like they was above maintaining a timesheet, that's slow money. Like they talked like they was above the 9 to 5. Like, I'm smarter because I got this street knowledge to get this money quicker than just your everyday Joe Blow who's doing the 9 to 5 job. This is basically like the movie Boys in the Hood. You know, we have Trey's dad trying to tell him like, hey, we live in Compton, but there's a way out. Like, you can get past all of this. You don't have to be a ball player. You can be someone who's a businessman. You can get out of this. You can wear the suit and tie. You can have a normal life. It's hard to understand that at such a young age, especially when the people that you hang out with do not have those aspirations, don't have that mentality. He says he picked up the family business at 13, and at 19, he was handed a sentence for getting caught, and then that's when the felonies came in.
Around the same time as when you came in this world, me and your mama thinking, what the fuck we naming this girl? I told her Nina, the prettiest name that I could think of, for the prettiest thing my eyes had ever seen. I was 19, took me 2 felonies to see the trap this crooked ass system set
for
me.
2 felonies now.
And now I fear it's too late for me to ever be the one to set examples that was never set for me. I'm living fast, but not fast enough, cause karma keeps on catching up to me. And if my past becomes the death of me, I hope you understand.
For your eyes, do you understand?
Do you see the cyclical nature that he's talking about? It took him 2 felonies for him to realize that this is all a trap. And now he can't ever be the person he was before because these felonies follow him around everywhere. His karma's catching up to him. And he may not ever be the one to be able to set these examples. One, because he's already lived that past life, and how is he gonna be able to say, do what I do, when he's already gone to prison for 2 felonies. But 2, he may not be able to set those examples because of the fact that he might lose his life because the past that he's had and the path that he's taken might be the death of him. That's a crazy story. And I'm not saying that this is a real story. I mean, I know that this is based off of real events and a real thing, but as a storyteller, for J. Cole to have the foresight and have the knowledge and capability to be able to write the story in this way, where we don't realize that this is J. Cole telling a story for someone else until like an hour into the album, it's genius.
In several ways I could have went out, too many to count. Was it the trigger happy crackers that the badges give clout? Was it the young niggas blasted frustrated cause the cash running out? Niggas don't know how to act in a drought. See baby,
several ways I could have went out. Like, I'm out, you're listening to this track, so you're hearing me, I'm dead at this point. The trigger happy crackers that the badges give clout. He's talking about the policeman. Without saying it, he's saying it. Like, is it the fact that somebody shot me, like a cop shot me because of my skin color and didn't give me due process? Or was it these young people frustrated because the cash running out, they really don't know how to act in a drought? When the well dries up, that's when you start to see who people really are.
Niggas don't know how to act in a drought. See, baby girl, I realized my definition of a real nigga was skewed. My views misshaped by new mixtapes that confirm the shit I learned in the streets was true. That real niggas don't speak when they beef with you. They just pull up on your street, let the heat have you. And if a real nigga hungry, he gon' eat your food. I was a fool. Spent all my time ducking school, ducking cops, ducking rules, hugging blacks that don't love you.
God, I pray you. That right there is a bar. See, baby girl, I realized that my definition of a real was skewed. My views misshaped by new mixtapes. He's basically saying my views were skewed. Like, I thought that that's what a real person was. I thought that's what someone was. I thought they hustled on the block. You know, they commanded respect from people. But that's not true. he realized after the fact and realized a little too late that that's not what actual real men do. And that's, again, I feel like that's the way my friend was living his life. Like, you know, he caught felonies for trying to do things at a young age. So sometimes it takes the birth of a child, or sometimes it takes a major like switch to turn on your head to say that everything that I thought was real is definitely not. He says, I spend all my time ducking schools, ducking rules, ducking cops, hugging these blocks that don't love you. I'm hugging these blocks like I love my block. I'm hugging you, and the blocks don't love you back. The streets don't love you back. You're just another body in the streets. Why are you even repping this life? There's no need to be ducking straight and narrow path. It's a hard path to take, especially when you grow up the way he did, but it's not impossible.
I pray you find a nigga with goals and point of views much broader than the corner. If not, it's gonna corner you.
Oof.
Into a box where your son don't even know his pops. In the cyclical nature of doing time continues. My worst fears.
Basically that I hope you meet a man who is nothing like me. I hope you meet a man with his own goals, his own aspirations in life that are bigger than the block, that are bigger than the corner. If not, it's gonna corner you into the same type of shit that I'm dealing with right now. Imagine this is the things that you would normally tell your daughter or your son, you know, as they're growing up. You have years to instill this in their head. And here he is trying to instill it in a couple of bars. That's such a dope line, because he's giving her advice through this mixtape that she's only hearing because she lost her pops and she doesn't know who he is. Go find you somebody that's not like me, or you're gonna be in the exact situation that you're in, where your child doesn't know who their dad is. And then the cyclical nature of this entire hood continues.
And the cyclical nature of doing time continues. My worst fear is one day that you come home from school and see your father's face while hearing about tragedy on news. I got the strangest feeling your daddy gonna lose his life soon. And sadly, if you listening now, it must mean it's true. But maybe there's a chance that it's not. And this album remains locked in a hard drive like valuable jewels. And I can teach you this in person like I'm teaching you to tie your own shoes. I love you and I hope to God I don't lose you for your eyes on.
This hits me right now because this is exactly how we found out about my friend's passing. My worst fear is that one day you come home from school and see your father's face while hearing about tragedy on news. Like, we woke up, didn't know it was him. We woke up and saw it, felt bad for whoever it was. And then we got the call saying that it was our friend. Don't even know how to feel about it still, to be honest. It hasn't even processed. And he says, I got the strangest feeling your daddy gonna lose his life soon. And if you listen to this right now, it must mean it's true. But one of my best friends called him because he had that gut feeling that something was gonna happen to him. Called him at 1:40 a.m. and said, hey, you good? And he was like, yeah, I'm chilling. I'm here at the house. Just to check up on him, hung up. We found out the next morning that he left and, you know, got killed. It's crazy that how that gut feeling happens like that. But then he says, maybe there's a chance that it's not, and this album remains locked in the hard drive like valuable jewels, like locked in the treasure chest. And I can teach you this in person. Like I was saying earlier, I have all these years to teach you all these things. Like I would teach you to tie your own shoes. I love you and I hope to God I don't lose you. That could literally mean like I don't lose you because I died, but also the fact that after my death, I hope I don't lose you, and I hope that you try to remember who I was and try to remember everything that I'm trying to teach you right now. That's a crazy line. And it's not until this point that you realize that the entire album is told through somebody else's eyes, somebody else's point of view. It strikes you so much harder when you don't realize that you're listening to this album that's being told through somebody else's eyes other than J. Cole until the very last moment, and then you replay the entire album in your head. This is one of those albums, like, you can tell it's like, fuck if it's popular. I don't care if anybody listens to it other than this one girl. I don't care if anybody listens to it or hears it other than me and her. I'm writing it to write it. You see, it's also a very important verse because of the fact that it sounds like the album is over. Like, we hear the instrumental for like 16 bars in a row, just straight. And then J. Cole all of a sudden appears again and then starts talking from a completely different perspective.
One day your daddy called me, told me he had a funny feeling. What he been dealing with lately, he wasn't telling. I tried to pick his brain, still he wasn't revealing. But I could feel the sense of panic in his voice and it was chilling. He said, Jermaine, I knew you since we was cheering. I never asked for nothing. When times was hard, I never had discussions with you begging you to help me. I dealt with the repercussions of my actions. I know you tried to steer me away from that shit, but that shit was in my blood. You know my life, I know your mama, nigga, send my love. In case I never get a chance to speak again, I won't forget the weekend spent sleeping at your crib. That's the way I wish my family lived.
See, so now he's telling the story through his own eyes. J. Cole saying that your dad called me And he wasn't telling me what was going on, but I could hear that something was wrong in his voice, and it was chilling. I kept you out of my life. I kept you out of my hard times. Anything that I did wrong, I dealt with my own repercussions. I never put it on you. And he says, I know you tried to steer me away from that shit, talking about the drug game, talking about the streets. You tried to show me a better way, but that shit was in my blood. Like, I felt like I didn't have any other choice. Like, this is a phone call conversation that he's having with J. Cole. Imagine hearing this from your friend, speaking his own death into existence, like going over his final thoughts and his final rights and saying everything that he has to say because he knows that something's gonna happen soon. In case we never get the chance to speak again, like literally foreshadowing to his death. I won't forget the weekend spent at your crib. I wish that that's the way that my family live. Like, you got it good, bro. Like, don't ever dive into the world that I dove into because you had a much better upbringing. You know, use it to your advantage and go do something with your life.
That's the way I wish my family lived, but my granny crib was in the jets. I had to interject, like, nigga, what you talking about? Fuck is you getting at? He said, listen, I got no time to dive into the scriptures, but I've been having premonitions. Just call it visions from the other side. I got a feeling I won't see tomorrow, like the time I'm living on is borrowed. With that said, the only thing I'm proud to say, I was a father. Write my story down, and if I pass, go play it for my daughter when she ready. And so I'm leaving you this record for your eyes only. Don't you ever scratch or disrespect it. Disrespect.
You see? And it's literally the second half of the last verse of the album where we realize that J. Cole is talking to this young lady's daughter. Like, the only reason we're hearing this is because your dad is dead. So don't you ever disrespect this record. Don't you ever do anything to disrespect this record. But back to what he was saying, he says, I wish that that was the way that my family lived, but my grandma's house was in the Jex. Talking about the projects. Jex is short for projects. And then J. Cole's like, what are you getting at, bro? Like, why are you even saying these things? I've been having premonitions of the other side. Like, the time I'm living on is borrowed. My friend's death and just death in general always reminds me that the time we're living on is borrowed and we have no say when that time is going to be running up. With that said, the only thing that I'm proud to say is that I was a father. That's a powerful line. And I feel like if my friend had the capability to write his last thoughts before he passed, he would say, the only thing that I'm proud to say is that I was a barber. I made people's lives better. They left my chair with happiness. They left my chair hype. He would say that he was proud to be a good friend, because he was one of the best friends that we will ever have. He would also say that he's glad that he was a father to his baby boy. So he's saying, write my story down, everything that I'm telling you on the phone, write, and everything that you know about me, write my story down and play it for my daughter when she's ready. And then we go back to J. Cole, and he's saying, so I'm leaving you this record for your eyes only, hence the name of the song and the album title.
And so I'm leaving you this record for your eyes only. Don't you ever scratch or disrespect it. This perspective is a real one, another lost bill, son. I dedicate these words to you and all the other children affected by the massive incarceration in this nation that sent your pops to prison when he needed education. Sometimes I think this segregation would have done us better. Although I know that means that I would never be brought into this world, because my daddy was so thrilled when he found him a white girl to take back to Jonesboro with Lil Zach and Cole Rare, barely 1 year old. Now it's 30 years later, making sure the story's told. Girl, your daddy was a real nigga.
So now it's J. Cole giving his own thoughts on what happened to her father. It's a problem of mass incarceration in this nation. So while the story is about him and the story is directly dedicated to you, he's saying don't disrespect it, because this story goes out there to anybody who's having to deal with this, the mass incarceration, the fact that the cyclical nature of the hood, it just never seems, it just snatches up people, another lost Ville son, another lost son. And then he says, this is a crazy line, that sometimes I think that segregation would have done us better. And that's something that a lot of people ponder on sometimes, but it's hard to say because we don't know what would have happened. And then J. Cole is reminiscing on his own life because he's kind of caught in this, maybe it would have done us better, but I knew if there was apartheid or anything like that, there would be no way that I would even be here alive to tell the story about your father, because my dad is black and my mom is white. And the story is that your daddy was a real one. And I feel like that's something that we're going to be able to tell to my friend's son, is that your dad was one of the realest people that I've ever known by a long shot. There's people that go out there and let their obstacles and let their downfalls turn them into the person that they are. They sulk and they feel bad for themselves. But this guy was not one of those guys. Just like apparently J. Cole's friend in the story was not one of those guys.
Girl, your daddy was a real nigga. Not cause he was cold. Not because he was the first to get some pussy 12 years old. Not because he used to come through in the caddy on some Vogues. Not because he went from bagging up them grams to serving those. Now your daddy was a real nigga. Not cause he was hard. Not because he lived a life of crime and sat behind some bars. Not because he screamed fuck the law, although that was true. Your daddy was a real nigga cause he loved you. For your eyes only.
Damn. When I first heard that last line of the album, it hit me so hard. But now that this has happened in my life, it's hitting me even harder because this song is basically my friend's life. And before we start talking about my friend again, you know, just to go back to the album and the concept behind the album, earlier in the song when he says that my views misshaped from new mixtapes talking about all the things that drugs and violence and, you know, living the life of money and having the cars and things like that, he thought that that was a real one. That verse, we don't hear what he actually figured out was the real way to live. So J. Cole is here at the very end of the song telling us what her father figured out for him because he's gone. He says, your daddy was a real one, not because he was cold, not because he was the first to get some pussy at 12 years old, not because he was the first one to have sex, lose his virginity. A lot of people would think like, damn, you cool for that. Not because he used to come through in the caddy on some Vogues. You know, that materialistic lifestyle isn't what made him real, so don't listen to this rap music that's telling you that that's what a real dude is. Not because he went from bagging up the grams to serving O's. He went from serving grams of cocaine to OZs, which is ounces of cocaine, which means he would have moved up in the ranks of the drug world of the streets. And that would have made him have more respect, technically speaking. And he's saying, nah, that's not why your daddy was real. He's not hard because he lived a life of crime and sat behind some bars. Not because he screamed, fuck the law, although that was true. Like, he did say that. And so did my friend. He was not about the law or anything of that nature. He says, your daddy was a real one because he loved you. And that's what we're going to have to instill in my friend's son. Like, your daddy was real. Your father was a real dude. Like, we loved him. He could have went on that life of crime. He could have went down that spree of selling drugs, you know, those kind of things. But he decided to cut hair. He decided to live as straight life as possible. Yes, he was kind of a rowdy dude. He had a short temper, things of that nature. That's not what made him the real one. What made him the real one is that he was here for us, and he would have been here for you had he not lost his life yesterday. This is a long video, I'm sure of it, but that entire song is basically my dedication to my friend Johnny Guzman and his entire family and all of my friends who are suffering. If you hadn't heard this song or didn't realize that it's J. Cole or didn't realize this entire album was J. Cole writing in the perspective of somebody else, and this is your first time noticing that, go back and listen to the song in order, and you'll basically hear the entire life story of his friend. For all the new viewers who have made it all the way this far, I'm sorry that the mood and the energy in this video is a little lacking compared to my previous videos, but that's the way life is, you know? I'm not out here trying to pretend like everything's all well and good when it's not. That's not real life. People subscribe to this channel because I keep it as true as I possibly can. If I'm going through it, you're gonna know about it. If you like this video, leave a comment, like I said. If you like this song, or if you just wanna send my friend some love, if you wanna send some love to the family of my friend who lost his life yesterday, you know, whether it's prayers, whether it's love, whether it's thoughts or vibes, whatever you feel like doing, please do that, because I'm sure that would definitely feel good to know that people around the world are thinking about them. Thank y'all guys for being here as always. See y'all in the next video. Peace out.